Hello, everyone. I'm Julie Scroggins, Community Program Managers West at the Tuberous Sclerosis Alliance, and I'd like to welcome you to today's webinar, Tips for Navigating Unemployment and the CARES Act During COVID-19. Thank you for joining us. As we've noted before, the TS Alliance understands these times are challenging for everyone, especially the TSC community. So our hope is that our ongoing webinars and town halls are useful to you. Today, we're very fortunate to have Jorie Cummis with us. Jorie is the Chief Executive Officer at NSN Employer Services. NSN provides unemployment cost control for more than 5,000 for-profit and non-for-profit employers across the United States. When Jorie's presentation is done, we'll have some time for open discussion, question and answer period. You'll be able to submit written questions using Zoom conferencing's chat function. Our moderator will forward your questions to Jorie. I hope you will all understand we may not be able to answer everyone's questions due to time constraints, so we'll work to answer questions that have relevance to as many of you as possible. We're also recording today's webinar, which will be available on the TS Alliance's website and our YouTube channel. It'll also be shared on social media sites like Facebook. It's now my pleasure to turn things over to Jorie.
Thank you, Julie. Thank you, everybody. Thanks for having me this evening. I really wanted to get started and jump right in and talk about how unemployment first got started. I think it's really important to have a good understanding of what's happening now, to understand what the purpose is to begin with of unemployment and where it came from. In fact, it came actually out of the New Deal as we as a country tried to come out of the Great Depression, sounding a little bit similar to what's going on today. In fact, the unemployment rate just came out today at 14.7%. That is the highest unemployment rate we've seen as a country since the Great Depression. So the purpose of unemployment is to provide short-term wages to people who are out of work due to no fault of their own. And the reason this whole program got started is because at the time of the Great Depression, the country had never seen unemployment like they saw. And now we're looking at very, very similar times. So again, it's really important to understand the background of unemployment, what its purpose is, and why you may or may not be eligible. And one thing I do want to point out is how unemployment is funded. When it was set up back out of the New Deal, it was set up on it's a federal program that has mandated each state to have their own system. So with 50 different states, we actually have 50 different systems, 50 different types of documents. That's why you're gonna see differences among the states. But what we're gonna talk about today really are just major concepts that will apply across the board. If you do have individual state-specific comments or questions, I can help you and tell you where to go to get those. But today we're going to be mostly talking about generics. But let's get back to how unemployment is funded, actually. It is funded 100% by employers. And it's funded through a payroll tax. So employees aren't paying into it. The government isn't paying into it. Employers are 100% responsible. And the way that money is created into this fund, like I said, is a payroll tax based on how much in wages the employer has paid out. Now, if the employer has a major layoff, they're going to be using a lot more of the fund, of the unemployment fund, to pay those wages. So inherently, an unemployment rate is going to go up. So what's happening now is that across the board, employers are going to see increases in unemployment rates just because that money that is being pulled out of these funds needs to somehow get replenished. So that's a little bit of the background and the funding of the unemployment trust fund. Now, if we go back to the original reason for setting up unemployment, it's a short-term replacement of wages went out of work due to no fault of your own. The way it is determined whether somebody's eligible to collect unemployment would be based off of that principle. The first eligibility requirement in order to be able to collect benefits at the state level is that you have to be out of work due to no fault of your own. Obviously, if you quit and you cannot prove good cause to the employer, you would not then be entitled to unemployment benefits. Conversely, if you were discharged for reasons that have to do with misconduct, at the same time, you would be ineligible. Given the situation that we are in right now, with people being out of work because of a major pandemic, this is obviously due to no fault of the claimant. Obviously, the claimant didn't have much to do with this. So it would already check that top eligibility box of being out of work due to no fault of your own. Now, there's other eligibility requirements that also need to be met when the state is looking to see if you're eligible for benefits. You have to be able to work, you have to be available for work, and you have to be actively seeking work. And again, I bring this up because the whole idea is that this is just a short-term relief of wages. The intention is that if somebody's going to be collecting these wages, that they can work and they are looking for other work. It's not meant to be a sort of lifestyle change to just be without a job, but the intent is that somebody is looking for work to then be off unemployment and have other full employment somewhere else. So right now, what's happening is the actively seeking work eligibility requirement in most states at this point has been waived. There's obviously nowhere to get work these days. And so the states have generously allowed that you actually don't have to look for work. But that is only if you are planning on going back to the job that you had when you were let go due to COVID-19. As long as you can prove that you will have a job as soon as businesses regain and come back and open up again, then you do not have to do the work search and they'll waive it. However, you still have to be able to work and you have to be available for work. Those eligibility requirements are still there. And I say this specifically if somebody's actually sick with COVID-19, they're not actually eligible under the eligibility requirements set right now at the state level. So in order to get, again, I want to just reiterate those requirements that need to be met in order to be able to collect unemployment benefits. You have to be out of work due to no fault of your own. You have to be able, available, and actively seeking work. So if somebody has been denied, most likely it is because they did not meet any of those eligibility requirements. Now, there are also some basic wage requirements as well. You have to have earned a certain level of wages, and that's different per state. But for the most part, if you've met all of those criteria, you should not have a problem being able to collect unemployment benefits at this time. So the next thing I want to talk about is where we are now today, what things have changed, what has the CARES Act now brought into it. If it's okay, I just want to share my screen for one moment. Can everybody see my screen? Okay. So what this shows is the amount of claims that have been filed in the current US unemployment system. So that takes into account the entire 50 states. Now, if you look back January, February, we were in one of the best economies that we've had in a very long time. I think it was 11 years in a bull, they use the word bull economy. And we were seeing very low unemployment rates. And literally, as this graph shows, overnight, the unemployment claims rose to levels that have never been seen since the Great Depression. And it went from, as you could see, one week in March, you're at about 200,000 claims being filed per week, all the way up to over 3 million. And then you could see it climb throughout April. And since mid-April, the amount has come down a little bit. We're talking a total of 30 million claims have been filed. Now, last year alone, the United States saw a total of about 770,000 claims. The amount of claims is staggering. And we'll talk a little bit about what then, because of this, to expect as you go through the unemployment process. So I'm going to leave this up just for reference purposes. But one thing I want to talk about now is the CARES Act. The CARES Act was part of the relief program that the government, I think the $3.2 trillion relief program the government, federal government, set in place. And there's about four sections that would be applicable, important to somebody who is collecting benefits at this time. The first, section 2014, that is the section that allows for an additional $600 a week to each claimant. What, in order to collect that $600 a week, all you need is to be eligible to collect even $1 under your state eligibility requirements. So we go back to what I talked about earlier. If you're eligible and can collect, then you are eligible for the additional $600 a week. So that $600 a week is available to you through July 31st of this year. And then, depending on the number of weeks that are allowed in the state in which you're collecting, you would have the remaining amount of weeks at your regular state formula, what they've calculated for your weekly benefit amount without the $600. Now, in addition, the next section is where of the CARES Act, it's 2107. That section has added an additional 13 weeks of eligibility for unemployment onto whatever the state that you're filing in currently has as a maximum. Most states right now are around 26 weeks worth of eligibility being able to collect unemployment. Now, with this specific section of the CARES Act, there's an additional 13. So you'd see somewhere around 39 weeks total to be able to collect unemployment benefits at this time. Another section of the CARES Act is the federal government actually allowed and gave money to states to waive the initial waiting period for when you first file a claim. Usually a state has about 2 to 3 weeks waiting period before you actually see any money coming to you, and that was waived. And so states are able to pay people right away and waive that waiting period. That waiting period really is set so that the state can take a look at your claim. They actually reach out to the employer to get the employer side of the story regarding the separation, just to make sure that you are out of work due to no fault of your own. And they collect that information and then make a decision based on what was provided to them at the time the claim was filed, and then also versus what the employer said, and then they make a decision. Right now, they are waiving that, and claimants are actually being able to collect money much faster. And then lastly, the CARES Act allows for states to put together an entirely separate system of unemployment for people who are not eligible under the regular state system. So if for whatever reason you don't meet any of those eligibility requirements that we spoke of, there is a possibility you would be eligible under what's called the PUA system, the Pandemic Unemployment Assistance Program. And each state has been given funds from the federal government to set up this separate system. This is for people who possibly are a 1099 employee, possibly a gig economy employee, those who would not regularly be eligible under the regular state, the state eligibility requirements. Now also too, as we mentioned, if you're sick right now and you are not eligible under the normal state eligibility requirements, you may be eligible for this new PUA system. So they have expanded who can collect unemployment benefits at this time. So that's a little bit about what the CARES Act did. In response to, if we look back at the graph that I've showed you, in order to tackle some of that and help with the, and give some financial assistance with this unprecedented amount of claims. So what does this all mean for you as a claimant trying to collect unemployment benefits? Well, just looking at the volume alone, there's just no way that states right now have the capabilities to process through this type of volume. And I say that to make sure to give warning that patience is required right now as the states do the best they can to process through the volume. I know that a lot of states have actually closed their doors as stay-at-home orders would reflect and affect them as well. And there's really no local offices to even speak to somebody at. And all of the filing for benefits is done online at this point. So that is a huge change from the unemployment system. Usually there's always somebody you can talk to at the stateside, but at this point, all I hear from claimants is the trouble that they are having. And while there is trouble reaching somebody, there is always action that can be taken. And we can talk about that, of what steps you can take as far as probably you can appeal a decision that you've received. And eventually you will hear from them. I think that the best way to handle this is just to really understand the patience needed right now as they try to process through the volumes of this claim. So I know you definitely will experience long wait times if you do try to call. They're doing the best they can to respond. Even a couple of states, as this volume of people were online, the systems were crashing. I mean, this is just unprecedented times, and it's really understandable how it can be frustrating, but they're really trying to do the best they can. I know that a lot of states have added resources to their systems just to be able to handle this type of volume. I have a few questions. Maybe we can take some questions now. If there's anything I can answer, I'd love to.
Yeah, absolutely. One question that has come in is there anything special for families of children with disabilities when it comes to unemployment?
No, there's nothing special. Some states do, however, have an allowance for dependents. So you might be able to collect an additional amount for dependents, regardless of disability or not. But that is state by state dependent.
How would someone start applying for unemployment?
The best thing to do is to go online and go to your state website. Usually you can find it under the Department of Labor in your state. That's really the only way to do it at this time, because there are no local offices available. So everything is done online at this point.
We have a question from a social worker. How can I best support my clients that I work with when it comes to employment and unemployment?
Well, I think, like I've been trying to implore upon all of the listeners today, patience is the best way to deal with this situation. There really is no way around it. It is just unprecedented, and everybody is really doing the best that they can. And when you do get in touch with somebody, finally, they're more than willing to help. It's just that the resources are few and far between these days at the unemployment offices.
Are there things to avoid doing when filling out the application?
Absolutely. You want to make sure that you do say you're separated due to no fault of your own. So if you're out of work and they ask you, are you willing to still work? You want to make sure that you say, yes, you are willing to work. They don't want to know that, I guess let me explain this in a different way. You have to be able to work. And even though you have a job, you still want them to know that you are able to work, even though you're not working right now, if that makes any sense. The way the unemployment office is going to look at it is they want to make sure that you are able and available to work. So when they ask you if you are available for work, you want to make sure you say yes. Even though you have plans on going back to your employer, you say yes, you are available for work.
If somebody's hours are reduced, but they aren't laid off, do they still qualify for any benefits?
They do, actually. It's what's considered underemployed. And each state has its own calculation of how much you'd be eligible to collect in that state. But yes, you are eligible to collect at that point.
Where can people find information about their state's process and requirements?
So you can go online to your state's website. Most of them have FAQs set up, frequently asked questions, and they're usually really helpful sites. If you need a specific state that you're looking for, let me know. I'd be more than happy to guide you and tell you and actually just give you the website address of that specific state of where you can go.
What's the difference between being let go, laid off, and furloughed?
So being laid off means that you are out of work with no intentions of being asked back. A furlough means that you are out of work for short term and are expected to be recalled in anywhere from about 60 to 90 days. So the real difference is that there's an actual recall date versus no recall date.
And just as a reminder, how are benefits determined for each person?
So again, it's each state has a different calculation, but for the most part, the states are going to look back at your earnings for the previous 18 months prior to your date of claim. And they're going to look at usually the two highest quarters of earnings and take approximately 47%. Again, that's a generality, and each state has a different calculation, but that should give you kind of a guide on how much you could be eligible for in each state.
Another question from the chat. If a state has published guidance for chronic health patients to remain home, does the CARES Act protect their unemployment?
So no, actually it doesn't. And that's what, I'm sorry, it does under the PUA system that I mentioned earlier. That's the pandemic unemployment assistance. So under the regular state unemployment system, you would not be eligible for the sheer fact that you are not able to work and available to work. And so someone like you would really benefit from the PUA system, which each state should have set up by now. And that was part of the CARES Act.
Great. We're getting some questions in from the chat. And again, if you have questions, please feel free to ask them in the chat. Are the benefits that are awarded taxed on the following tax year?
They are taxed. A lot of states will actually deduct the taxes prior to even giving you any money. So I've seen some claimants who their deductions were more than what they were earning and ended up not getting any. So that if you see that, that could be why you might get something back from the state saying that you have maxed out your deductions, and you might be thinking, what deductions? And it's actually the state or federal income tax.
Another question from the chat. If you are able to get a part-time job, should you take the offer, and will you still qualify for unemployment as an underemployed person?
So is just to clarify, is it going from zero wages up to part-time wages? And really what you have to look at is comparing that to how much did you make in the 18 months prior. So if you made enough to qualify for, let's say, maximum unemployment benefits, and then because you're not working at all, but then you take a part-time job, those earnings from the part-time job would be deducted from what you could actually earn in unemployment. But you'd have to calculate it out. It might be to a point where you might be better off because you might get your unemployment plus the wages from part-time, and that might exceed where you're already at. So it's something to look into, and would you'd want to calculate that out and see what's in your best interest.
Another question from the chat. If furloughed, do you qualify for benefits?
Absolutely. That's really what unemployment is all about. It's short-term wages when you're out of work due to no fault of your own. So yes, furlough is exactly what unemployment is for.
And then you've talked about the need for patience in this situation, in this really unprecedented situation. But if somebody is denied, what steps can they take to either appeal or to move forward?
So usually you're given a document, the state would send you notification of the denial, and within that denial would be exactly how you can appeal that decision. And usually it is by sending some type of written documentation into the state. Now, what'll happen when you do that is the state will then schedule an administrative law hearing, which is presided over by a judge, and it's very much sort of like a mini trial where you're sworn in under oath and you would be asked to give your testimony, and then your employer is also invited to this hearing, and they might also as well have testimony to give. So the next step would be doing this administrative law hearing.
And then what are the steps after that?
So actually there is another step. So once the judge that presides over this hearing gives his decision, there's another step of appeal even after that. So you can actually appeal that decision, and that then goes to a board of review who reviews the hearing, goes over the testimony that was given, and the board of review can then be another level of appeal on this decision. Once their board of review makes their final decision, it's out of the unemployment system, this claim at this point, and the next step for appeal would be to circuit court. But then it's not following the same rules as the unemployment system. It would then follow whatever circuit court you file, and it would have to file those laws and rules.
Great. If you were to distill this whole presentation into one lasting lesson you want people watching to take away with them, what would it be?
Wow, that's a big question. I really think, and I know I said it a lot, but this is levels that no one has ever in our lifetime have seen before. And really to understand just the gravity of what is going on, and to know you will be taken care of. That is the goal of the federal government, as shown by them putting together the CARES Act. It just might mean a little bit of patience.
And you mentioned you'd be more than willing to share additional resources to people who need them. How can people get in contact with you?
I can give you that right now if anyone's interested, or I know Julie can provide my contact information to anybody who emails her. I'm more than happy to help and talk and refer you any which way I can to the most beneficial resources for you.
We really appreciate you being so open to sharing resources and to helping TSC families in need. There aren't any more questions in the chat, but are there any other resources or messages that you'd like to share?
Just please have patience. As I work with this every single day, I can tell you that we are seeing the rate slowing down. We are on the downside of the claims being filed, which really means that the state is going to have more resources available to help, and maybe you won't need as much as those patients as I've been pleading for. But I definitely am starting to see a turn in the amount of claims that we're processing on a regular basis. So that's a good sign. We're heading the right direction, that's for sure.
That's definitely reassuring to hear. And, you know, we're so grateful for you taking the time this evening to educate us a little bit more on unemployment and the CARES Act, and for all the support you've offered. We really appreciate it.
Oh, you're very welcome. Please feel free to reach out at any time. I'm more than happy to help.
So that'll do it for today's presentation. As mentioned at the top, this presentation was recorded, and we'll be sharing it on our website and on social media shortly. And if you have any specific questions that you didn't ask during the presentation and would like to ask them later, please feel free to send an email to Julie Scroggins, and she will forward it to Jorie to help connect you to the resources you need. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in, and have a great night.
Thank you, everybody. Good night.
Thank you, Jorie. Thanks, everyone.